Amen. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus.
Yeah. I will give you my life. You want King James or Amplified?
Either one.
Okay. King James says, "And you hath he quickened who were dead in trespasses and sins."
Okay. And the New King James Version says, "You he has made alive who were dead in trespasses and sin."
Yeah.
And once you walk according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, the spirit who now works in the sons of disobedience, among whom also we all once conducted ourselves in the lust of our flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind, and were by nature children of wrath, just as the others. But God,
amen,
he is rich in mercy, because of his great love, which he loved us.
Thank you, Lord.
Even when we were dead in our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved.
Thank you, Lord.
Raised us up together and made us sit together in the heavenly places with Christ Jesus. You have not been called to be ordinary people.
Amen.
If you know Jesus Christ as your Savior, you have not been called to be like everybody else.
That's right.
And I want to talk to you about that tonight. I also want to take you to Romans 12 and 1. I'm going to let them lay out the plan here, okay? Bear with me. Romans 12 and 1. Most of you know this by heart. I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service. Who you were at one time is not who you are.
Amen.
Now, in both of those scriptures, Who is he talking to? Who is he speaking to in both of those scriptures? In Ephesians and in Romans, who is he talking to?
Talking to us.
Huh? What are you? You're a believer, are you not?
Mm-hmm.
You believe in Jesus Christ. He's not talking to Joe Blow on the street who knows nothing about God. He's talking to believers.
Yes.
He's saying, you have been raised up with Christ. He says that it is your reasonable service to sacrifice yourself to him. Is he not?
Yes.
It's your reasonable service. There has been a departure. There needs to be a departure of how we see ourselves. Because the way that we see ourselves many times is who we were. We don't see ourselves in who we are now. There's got to be a departure from that behind us.
Yeah.
And in order to make that departure, we need to begin to see ourselves as God does.
Yes.
As our Father does. When slavery was abolished, okay, we have this thing about slavery, but when it was abolished, do you know that there were many slaves that did not want to be free?
Yeah.
They chose not to be free. They wanted to remain in the condition that they were in. Why is that?
Because they didn't know nothing else.
Because they didn't know nothing else. Because they're used to what they're doing.
Right.
Were they not?
Mm-hmm.
Because they were afraid
of
what the future held. If I leave here, I'm fed. I'm watered. Yeah, I worked hard. It's difficult. And I may not be treated perfectly right. But at least I know I'm going to live.
Mm-hmm.
How many of us have stayed in that status quo? And when freedom is brought forth to us, is brought to us, it's handed over to us, it's shown to us that we can be free, but yet we choose to stay where we're at because it's comfortable.
Mm-hmm.
It may not be great, but it's comfortable. We know what's going to happen if we stay here. You see, the same thing happened with the Israelites. If you read of the Israelites, God took them out of Egypt where they had been slaves most of their life. 400 years. So most of those people were born into slavery.
Right.
It's all they knew. And when God brought them out of Egypt, what happened? They began, they were joyous at the very beginning.
Mm-hmm.
How many of us accepted Christ at the beginning and never ready to go?
Yep.
But then as we continue in our walk, not always do things go the way that we want them to go.
That's right.
So we start longing for our Egypt.
Mm-hmm.
We start longing to want to go back to what we know. Instead of pushing forward to the things that God has for us.
Mm-hmm.
It's easy to go backwards.
Yeah.
It's easy to step back. It's easy to go to that comfortable place right here and just sit.
Mm-hmm.
There's a story about a man who had a pig. And he cleaned the pig up. And he washed him down and everything. Took him in his house, loved on him. The first time that he decided to let the pig out, the pig went outside and he ran right back into the mud pile he came out of.
Yeah.
You laugh, but that's what happens to some of you.
Absolutely.
It happens to me.
Yep.
We get all cleaned up, God cleans us up, God's got us walking in the right direction, we're doing the right thing, and here comes along Sam, our buddy from way back. And what does he do? He hands us that dope, he hands us that drug, he hands us this. Or the first thing that goes wrong, it doesn't go exactly how we think it ought to go. Well, forget this. to go back into that slavery. We want to stay where we were because, you know what, we know what's going to happen there.
Mm-hmm.
It's hard to accept who we really are. It's one of the problems that we have. I want to take you to Gideon, that's Judges 6:11. Yes, I love you in the Bible. You see, sometimes it's really hard for us to accept who we are in Christ because we know who we were. We know what people have said about us. I want to take you to Judges 6:11. Everybody there?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, we got a couple of solutions. In Judges 6:11, it says, "Now the angel of the Lord came and said unto the timber tree, which was in Ophrah, which belonged to Joash the Bezerite, which his son Gideon threshed wheat in the winepress in order to hide it from the Midianites." What's happened here is Israel's gone against God, so God allows the Midianites to overtake them and to oppress them, basically is what's happening. Because the Israelites have turned their back on God once again. And all of a sudden, an angel of the Lord appears to him and said to him, "The Lord is with you, you mighty man of valor." Gideon's a farmer. Gideon's trying to have food for his family. God comes up and he looks at Gideon and he says, the angel comes up and he says, "You mighty man of valor." If God or an angel were to come up to you today and look at you, T, and say, "You mighty woman of valor." I'm sorry, I'd be having to go, "Who?"
Who, me?
Me? You talking to me? But that's what he said to Gideon. That's what he said to Gideon. God was speaking to Gideon's attention.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes God will put people in your life to speak into your life, not because that person's trying to blow smoke up your butt, but because that person sees something in you that you cannot see. I remember when I was first coming up, we were talking about this today. You know what? I started playing the guitar when my son was 8 years old. I said, "God, if you teach me, I'll sing to you." At that particular time, do you know that I never planned on singing in front of anyone else but God? And then this thing started working out. I wound up in a little Bible study, then I wound up in a restoration house, then I wound up here, then I wound up there, I wound up there. That was God doing it. And because a certain individual saw something in me that I did not see, I speak to you today.
Mm-hmm.
I would have never stood up on my own to speak. It wasn't in me. I didn't think. But God.
Amen.
You see, God, the angel spoke to who he knew Gideon could be. Gideon's response to that angel dealt with his past history. Listen. Gideon says to him, "O Lord my God, if the Lord is with us, why then has all this happened to us? And where are all the miracles which our fathers talked to us about, saying, did not the Lord bring us up from Egypt? But now the Lord has forsaken us and delivered us into the hand of Midian." He's talking about yesterday all the way down the line. "Well, I remember hearing the stories about the God of Egypt. I remember hearing the stories about this, that, and the other, but where is he today? I haven't seen him." You know what? In America, we can say that right now, couldn't we?
Yeah.
Because of the way things are going in our country, we could get off on that if we wanted to. But you know what? I believe that God's moving right now. or to sit down in our mess and stay in our mess.
Amen.
But all of it's our choice. We tend to lean on the past history and judge our future by it. Famous last words, that's what I've always done. That's how I've always been. That's what they told me I'd be or would not be. Past history, they did. That's what I've always done. We don't walk in victory of knowing who God says that we are. Why is that? Why can't you believe who God says you are? What does God say that you are? What does God say that Matthew is? What does God say that Brian is? What does God say that Jeff and Steve and Daryl's are? Does God call you stupid? Did God call you worthless?
No.
God hasn't said none of that to you, has he?
That's right.
Then why do you believe that stuff? Because if it's not God saying it to you, Butch, who's saying it to you? Why do you believe it? We need to quit underestimating ourselves.
Yes.
We need to start walking in who God says we are. We need to walk with our heads held up. We don't need to walk in shame anymore. We're children of a king.
Yes.
Going back to Ephesians 2:6. It says, but God, who is so rich in mercy because of his great love, which he loved us. Now, what kind of love does God have for you?
Great.
Great love.
What kind of love does he have for you, Jairus? Great love.
Great.
What does great love look like? What does that mean to you? If somebody has a great love for you, what does that mean to you?
Imagine.
Does that mean that he pays attention to who you are?
Mm-hmm.
Does that mean that he cares about where you go and what you do and who your friends are?
Yes, that's right.
Is that what it means?
Yes, what it means. Exactly what it means.
It is?
Yes,
man. Wow.
Amen.
Wow, that's pretty cool, huh?
Amen.
Because of his great love for you with which he loved us, even when we were dead in trespasses, even when we were in sin, even when we didn't know him, he made us alive together with Christ. Who is Christ? Christ is God's Son, is he not?
Yes.
We are alive with Christ.
Yes.
With him. We're not behind him. We're not in front of him. We are with him. Are you getting this yet?
Yes.
And raised us up together and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus.
Thank you, Lord.
Now, what does that look like? What does that really look like? What does that mean to us? Go to Ephesians 1:20. Which he worked in Christ when he raised him from the dead and seated him at his right hand in the heavenly places, far above all principalities and power and might and dominion and every name that is named, not only in this age, but also in that which is to come.
Yes.
So if Christ exceeded above all principalities and all powers and all might and all dominion, wherever
we're with him. Mm-hmm. We are with him. Yes.
90% of the time, American people especially walk in defeat because they don't understand the power of God. They don't understand that we're seated with Christ. They don't understand that Christ is in us.
Yes.
They don't understand about abiding in Christ and Christ us abiding in Him. They don't understand that concept, so therefore they don't walk in the victory that they should be walking in.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
If I'm in Christ, do I have to worry about my loved one that I love? Okay? Looking me in the eye and telling me I'm worthless? Mm-hmm. If I'm in Christ? Mm-hmm. No! Because I know who I am.
Yes.
I am His. I am in Christ. I am seated with Christ. When I sit down in this chair, He sits with me.
Yes.
When I walk down the road, He walks with me.
Yes.
It's not a separate thing.
That's right.
You're together. We are above. We are not beneath our problems. We're above, we're not beneath our circumstances.
Amen.
We are with Christ, in Christ Jesus. Deuteronomy tells us that we are the head and not the tail.
Yes, yes.
But we can walk around like we're somebody's butt. We're the ones that are supposed to be leading and not following.
That's right.
We should be ruling over life and not allowing life to rule over us.
Amen.
You catching on yet?
Yes, ma'am.
You should be ruling over your life instead of it ruling over you. So what stops us? Many times we walk defeated and we walk beaten down. You have to start thinking up in order to be up. You think negative, life's going to be negative. You think positive, guess what? Life's going to be positive.
Amen.
Do you see the cup half full or half empty? Which is the second hindrance is you don't know who you are or where you came from. You're not some toxic collision of gas, folks. And you certainly aren't anybody's monkey's uncle. Even if your genes and your DNA had to be made, no collision could do that. How can it be that even our fingerprints and our DNA is individual to each and every one of us? None of us are the same in those two areas. We each have different DNA. We each have different fingerprints. Now think about how many people are in Monroe, much less North Carolina, much less the United States, much less the world. You don't match anybody.
Isn't that awesome?
A Big Bang didn't do that, and evolution certainly didn't do it, and if evolution were then why are we so happy?
And
reject the thought that you just boomed into existence.
Amen.
Your origin, your beginning, your start came from a divine designer. You have designer genes. You don't have the Kmart brand.
Yes. Thank you, Lord.
Or the Walmart brand. Or the Target brand. And trust me, I buy all my stuff from Walmart. But you have a designer who designed you, each and every one of you. He designed you with a body, with a soul, with a spirit, and it did not come from a collision. Your other hindrance is the hindrance of approval of others. You need to know that you are his child and that you have favor with him. You don't need to worry about what other people think. Go to Isaiah 63:8. I figured this is the only way I can keep you awake, but you're moving in this book.
You said 63:8?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
This is God speaking. It says, for he said, surely they are my people, children who will not lie. So he became their Savior. He's talking about grown people.
Mm-hmm.
He ain't talking about the new babies. He's talking about grown people. Matthew 18:3 says, you have to come to me as a child, or you can't see the kingdom of heaven. How does a child come to you? Children have a total trust.
That's right.
Little kids, they're not afraid of anybody. They trust people. Mm-hmm. They believe in people. Mm-hmm. It's not until they start growing up and getting messed up.
That's right.
When they're little, they trust you unamazingly. They cling to your leg. They love on you. They don't reject you. Go to John 1:12. Listen to this part now. How many of us group have received Jesus Christ?
Amen.
Amen.
Yeah.
How many people have received Jesus as your Savior? Okay? But as many as received him, to them he gave the right to become adults of God.
Sons of God.
Old men of God. Old women of God. He gave you a right to be a child of God.
Amen.
A child of God. You have that right. Every now and then I put on Facebook that if I have grown up by 50, you can forget it. I ain't doing it. And I ain't doing it. Romans 8:16. Are you catching my drift yet?
Yes, ma'am.
Are you bored to death?
No.
Yes, Lord.
8:16. Here we go again. Ooh. The Spirit himself. Now you're talking about the Holy Spirit.
Yes.
Now he said to help you, right?
Yep. Amen. Yeah.
The Spirit himself bears witness with whose spirit?
Our spirit.
That we are what?
Children of God.
Children of God.
Praise God.
Children of God.
Children of God. You're a child of a king.
Thank you, Lord.
Ephesians 5:8 says that we are to walk as children of light. What light is that? The light of Jesus Christ. Because he is in us. He walks with us. Does he not?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Because if he's not, then you need to change some things.
Amen.
The last thing I think is that we walk around saying that we deserve what we get. We believe we've been so bad that whatever comes our way, I deserve it. Guess what? We all do.
That's right.
But it's only by the grace of God.
Amen.
That we don't receive what we deserve. Because salvation is a gift.
Thank you, Lord.
It's not something that's deserved.
Thank you, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
You need to wake up knowing that the favor of God is upon you every day.
Yes.
Go to Ephesians 2 and 10. Says, for we are his workmanship. Whose workmanship are you?
He is.
Yeah. Talk to me, folks.
God's.
You're his workmanship.
Yes.
Say, I am his workmanship.
I am his workmanship.
Say it again. I am his workmanship. Created in Christ Jesus for good works. What were you created for?
Good works.
Which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. So when did God prepare you to walk in the good works?
Beforehand.
Beforehand. When he was weaving you in your mother's womb, he knew the works that he had for you to do. He knew what he wanted you to do with your life.
Praise God.
Yes.
Does that mean that because maybe you screwed your life up and he said, forget you, man?
Not hardly.
No.
Not hardly.
You see, when it talks about the scripture where Paul's talking, it says neither height nor depth nor width nor seas nor anything else can separate us from the love of God. There is nothing that can stop God from loving you.
Amen.
But you can walk away from.
That's right.
Does that mean he stops loving you?
No.
There's nothing that can separate you from his love. But you can separate yourself.
Yes.
But he never stops loving you because of it.
That's right.
We are created to do the work of God. If we're to do the work of God, we need to walk in it. With our heads held high, knowing that we are chosen by God. Go to John 15. This was a scripture when I first started reading the Bible that absolutely blew my mind right here. Because all the time I thought I accepted Jesus as Lord and Savior. I did. Here we go. Starting in 15. No longer do I call you servants, for a servant does not know what his master is doing. But I have called you friends. For all things that I heard from my Father, I have made known to you. You did not choose me. But I chose you and appointed you that you should go and bear fruit and that your fruit should remain, that whatever you ask in my Father's name, he may give you. These things I command you, that you love one another. Did you choose God or did he choose you?
He chose us.
He chose us.
Yes. Thank you, Lord.
He chose us. To think that an almighty God, a creator of this universe, a creator of the world, a creator of all the people on this earth, and out of all the people on this earth, he bent down and he called on me.
Thank you, Lord.
Are you kidding me? Are you kidding me? You get one shot at life. You get one shot. At being chosen. It's not a coincidence. God planned for us to be here from the very beginning.
Yes.
Each and every one of us. And you get one shot to do what God's called you to do. Bear fruit. good works.
Thank you, Lord.
Doing the will of God and walking in His will. What are you going to do? You had an opportunity to hear God's word. You had an opportunity to know who Jesus Christ is. You had an opportunity to feed yourself as to who God is in your life. Now what are you going to do with it? Are you going to be like the seed that was sown and thrown on the rocky ground? Mm-hmm. And as soon as the sun came, it scorched it? Are you going to be like the seed that was thrown in the thorns? And as soon as the first thing in life comes up, you let it choke you out? Or are you going to be the good seed that was thrown on the good ground that takes root and that begins to thrive and begins to grow and begins to flourish? You see, all the seed falls on ground. The difference is the condition of the ground.
Yes.
The difference is what condition are you in? Are you in a condition to receive and to let it grow inside of you? Are you going to allow it to be choked out? Are you going to be allowed to be burnt up? You see, that's your choice. I can't make that choice for you. Only you can make that choice. Nobody can make that choice for you. What seed are you going to be? Are you going to be the thorny ground, the stony ground, or the good ground? See, I want to be a good ground. I don't want to be choked out.
Amen.
I don't want to be burned up. I don't want to walk out of here and forget what I've spoken to you. You are children of a mighty King. Walk in, folks.
Praise God.
Quit allowing the enemy to steal, kill, and destroy what God's trying to do in your life. Let's pray. Father, I thank you, Lord God, for these words. I thank you, Father, that you give me. I ask that you plant the seeds in each and every person in this room. Plant your seed, Father.
Yes, God.
And I'm asking for you, Lord God, to move and to use these men of heaven, Father God, for your kingdom, for your glory, Father, for your grace and for your mercy. Lord God, let them be seed sowers, Father God. Let them sow seed of who you are in their lives to others so that they can also grow and learn and flourish. And I ask it in Jesus' name, help them to understand who they really are in you.
Yes, Lord.
And to walk with you and in you. In Jesus' name, amen.